one more method, guys. We could do it one more time, one more way, and that you could do only when your bunch of resistors are equal. How do you do that? For you to find your R total, you're going to take a value of 1 guy divided by how many they are. Means number of resistors. So, value of one resistor divided by number of resistors. So let's say if you had value of one resistor, in this case is 6 ohm, which is equal. How many there were? 2 of them? Your answer is 3 ohm. That only works for, only works when your resistors are all equal. Or equal resistive loads, equal resistors. If your resistors are not equal, you could use this. If your resistors are more than 2, you gotta come up to here and find your answer. Once you copy this down, we're gonna practice 1 or 2 questions on it. The one I'm interested to do on the board are again parallel resistors. That's question number 5. Now we know we gotta do 1 over 1 over. We don't have any other choice. So in your question number 5, part B, he's giving it to you. Value of resistor 1 not given. R1 is not given. R2 is 3 ohm. And R total is 2 ohm. Okay? What you gotta do is you're gonna just follow the formula. R total is equal to inverse of R1 and R2. R total is 2, R1 is 3, R2, we need to figure it out. 1 over 2 is 0.5, 1 over 3 is decimal 3, 3 is 3 repeating. What do? I got a minus. I will minus 0.5 and decimal 3, 3 will lead to decimal 1664, 1 over R2. For me to find my R2, I will take inverse of this number that will lead to 6 ohms. So when you are given total, you're going to take inverse of them. First take the inverse and then minus them. If you're not given R total, you take the inverse and you add them. Whatever answer you get after adding or minusing, you take inverse of that number. Inverse means 1 over that number. So I would designate you guys to try doing at least C and D on your own. I'm not going to go ahead and do it. I'd rather ask you to do it. If you're done with 5th, try doing 6. Question number 6 right underneath that. If you want to write it down in a parallel circuit, R total is always less. R total is always less than the least value of resistor in that circuit. R total is always less than the least value of resistor in that circuit. R total is always less than the least value of resistor in that circuit. What that means is if I have a two resistors, 6 ohm and 5 ohm, my R total will be less than 5. If I had 3 resistors, 1 ohm, 2 ohm and 3 ohm, my final answer will be less than 1. If I had 4 resistors, 1, 2, 3, 4, my answer will be still less than 1. If I had 5 resistors, 10 ohm, 20 ohm, 30 ohm, 40 ohm and 50 ohm, what's my final answer? Less than 10. It's always less than the least value of the resistor in the parallel circuit. What we just covered, you'll be lucky to get only 2 questions. But I had to invest the time such that the basics of electrical are clear. That's why it's called basics of electrical. All we covered is Ohm's law and Watt's law. How do you do milli, micro, micro, mega, kilo? And move your zeros around to find the convert milli to ohm or milli ohm to ohm, kilo ohm to mega ohm. And the last part, which what we just covered, is series and parallel circuits. We haven't really covered much, but the reason I'm telling you why we invested all last 4 hours of our time is so basics come back before we start from here. So I'm going to give you half hour lunch break. You have been amazing class. I'll give you a 35 minute break. When you come on, is basics of Ohm's law, Watt's law. We worked on all the easy stuff. I taught you how to do, how to use Ohm's law triangle and Watt's law triangle to calculate voltage, current, resistance, or power, depending on whether you are given voltage or current or not, and you calculate power. If power and voltage is given, you can calculate current. Triangle makes your life much easier. Then we talked about resistor color coding. If I have three or four colors given, how can I calculate the resistor value and tolerances as well for the fourth band? Then we moved on to milli, micro, mega, kilo. How do you convert milliamp to amps, microamps to milliamps, kilohertz to hertz, microfarad to millifarad, all of that fun stuff. After that, we moved on and we worked on. Okay, what else did we do? Milli, micro, mega, kilo. We talked about series and parallel circuits. So we have done easy stuff. If you flip your page forward, the next heading says power factor correction. So the reason I chose to do this right after break, because this requires a lot of your attention to keep your ears and this window please open for the next half hour. It's very important. Okay? This is exactly what we used to do in grade 8 or 9 when we were taught trig. A squared plus B squared is equal to C squared. So I'm going to go ahead and show you what do you need to know such that you could get this question straight in your exam. Now, something called power factor, I'm sure you would have heard this term. Power factor is the relationship between watts and VA. Okay? Before we go ahead and talk about electrical, let's talk about math. In the math, we were taught that if I have a right angle triangle, okay, this is side A, this is side B, and this is side C, wherever the angle resides, I call that side as adjacent side. Just something for you guys to know. Okay, right opposite to that side is called the opposite side. Okay, the longest side of the triangle is called the hypotenuse. We all know that. Or I'm assuming that we all know that. We do, right? So what did Pythagoras' theorem state, or what did we really learn as kids? That we can take square of two sides to calculate square of the longest side. C is always, in this case, your two side square will lead to third side square. You sum them up and you will get the final answer. So let's say if I had this side being 3 centimeters and this side being 4 centimeters, as kids we were taught, how do you calculate the third side of the triangle? You take square of 3 and square of 4. Square of 3 is 9, square of 4 is 16. That's equal to C square. So C square leads to 25. If C squared is 25, what would be C? You will take square root of 25. That will lead to 5 centimeters. This will be your longest side of the triangle right here. Okay? Same principle we're going to use to do something called power factor. It's called power triangle. That's where I'm going to start with first. Okay? What does power triangle really mean? The easiest way to understand power triangle, of course, it's again a 90 degree triangle. On the bottom side of the triangle, you will put kilowatts. Kilowatts are called real power. They are also called true power. Two names, same meaning. Okay? I'll tell you in a bit how they are any different, not just ask you to cram the name. Okay? The other side of the triangle, this vertical side, is called reactive power. The reactive power is given by KVAR, kilovolt amp reactive, KVAR, they're called kVARs, okay? The third side of the triangle is called KVA, which is called apparent power. What is the basic difference between all these powers? End of the month, when we get charged by a utility company, this is what's perceived by the utility company, that this is what we practically used, but this is what actually we pay. What we practically use is the true power because of a resistive load. In our house, we have inductive loads like a baseboard heater, that's an inductive load. Stove in our house, it's still an inductive load. There loss of power because of inductive loads. Why? I turn the button on, what happens? The light comes on right after. We didn't lose any time, any power to let the equipment turn on. If I touch an equipment and if it's a naked wire, I will get electrocuted. What does that mean? Human body is a resistor as well. That's called a resistive load. The moment you give voltage, you get a response, which is called current. Okay? But in case of an inductive load, think about a baseboard heater. You turn your baseboard heater on, it takes, what, 60 seconds for that heater to turn on? Same thing, think about a stove in your house. You turn your stove on, it takes 30, 40, 50 seconds to get it to the final point. That's called charging and discharging of inductors and capacitors. If you would have guys done level 2 apprenticeship, that's all is taught. But what's important for you guys to know is, how am I going to get this question straight in the exam? If you were given, this is my real power, this is the power that I lost because of reactive components, that might be an inductor or a capacitor, what should be my apparent power? So square, square, two sides added together will give you third side square. And second thing you need to know is, what is power factor? Power factor is a relationship between what we practically use and what we paid to the utility company. When this relationship becomes one, means we have zero losses. Power factor is 100%. That doesn't exist, ideally. I would say the best I've seen any circuit that works is 92 or 93%. Average has been between 80 and 90% after improvement. Okay? But the goal always of any electrical utility company, the goal is to improve power factor so people don't lose power, so that they don't pay more than what they think they need to. How do they improve? By throwing some capacitors. That's called capacitive wars, which kill inductive wars. I could teach you 6 months of just this, because in your apprenticeship or second year, out of a 10-week program, only RLC circuits, that's what I'm teaching you, is R for resistor, L for inductor, and C for capacitor. RLC circuits on a 10-week program is at least 2 weeks are just spent on doing, oh, what is an inductor, what is the charging and discharging constant of an inductor, a capacitor, if I put them in series, what would happen, if I put them in parallel, what would happen, and then at least out of 1 week, out of the 2 weeks, at least 4 or 5 days just on power factor correction. That's what I'm going to teach you in the next 30 seconds, though, because that's in your exam, okay? Power factor correction means, right now, let's say I'm given a question that power factor is 70%, okay? My kilowatts is 1,000 kilowatts. What am I paying to utility company? 1,000 kilowatts is what I'm, or let's just like take an easy number, 1 kilowatt, okay? 1 kilowatt is what I'm practically using, but what am I paying to utility company when my power factor is 70%? 1 divided by 0.7, do the math for me. 1 is what I'm practically using, but when I'm paying to any utility company, I'm paying based on 1.42 kVA. I'm paying for that. Why? Because my power factor of any circuit or my home is not 100%. Are we good? Because there are inductive and capacitive components, and the loads that I work with, there is a motor which is an inductive load. What happens? There is some power that I'm sure I can teach you all about lagging and leading, but you're not taking second year apprenticeship. That's all is taught in second year. Inductor is a lagging component, capacitor is a leading component, kilowatts that are lagging are led by using some capacitors. Not in your exam, so why bother? All you need to know is, how would you improve your power factor from 70% to 100%? You will come up with all these losses that are created by inductive wars, you will throw some capacitive wars in it, such that you could end up having 0 wars. Okay? The exam question, very similar to the questions that you have in front of you. So we are going to go question after question on this one. I guarantee you, if you know 8 or 9 questions of these, you'll be fine. That's all technically you need to know from power factor correction standpoint. Okay? So I'm going to ask my first question. Harmon, you're going to give me the first answer. Power factor is equal to A, B, C, D, pick one.
It's a kilowatt divided by kVA.
Perfect. Because I've written down here, power factor is equal to watts over VA, or I can throw a kilo in the front. Or it'll become kilowatts over kilo VA. Same thing. Okay? Good job. The answer is D. So go ahead and mark if you need to mark, guys. Question number 2. If the load draws 800 kilowatts, power factor is 40%, how do I find my kVA? I need to find find my KVA, what do? I use this nice looking formula right here. I am given power factor of 40%, is that what's given?
Yeah.
Okay, and I'm given kilowatts. Kilowatts is what I'm practically using. Will I pay more than what I'm using, equal to what I'm using, or less than what I'm using? Because power factor is bad, it's only 40%. I'll pay so much more than that. So do I multiply 40%, which is 0.4, with 800, or divide?
Divide.
Because when I multiply, I'm going to get 800 times 0.4, which is 320. Can I use 800 and pay for 320? No. So 800 divided by 0.4. Why am I teaching you this technique? Because I know that I know out of 80% of my students, 75 are bad in math. So yeah, I can show you the formula and tell you to put numbers and move numbers around, but use your brain more than you use your formula. When you're paying to hydro or any utility company, you're going to pay more than what you have used because your power factor is bad. It's 40%. So you got to divide these numbers and find your answer rather than multiplying. Okay? So in this question, I'm going to now do it mathematically as well so it makes sense to you. Question number one, I am given power factor is 40%. I'm going to go write down the word 0.4 because it's 40%. I am given kilowatts of 800. All I have asked to do is find me my KVA and I'll be done. I'll get my one mark. How do I do it? I will use this formula right here. So power factor, which is 0.4, is equal to kilowatts. What's my kilowatts? 800. I got to find my KVA. Now I'm going to do grade 7 math. Okay, so pay attention. We were taught when our unknown is on the bottom, what do? We take this number up and flip it with the number that we know. So we can find the unknown. Okay, so KVA goes out of the house, 0.4 comes into the house. So KVA is given by 800 divided by 0.4. You should get 2000 KVA. That should be your answer. So technically what you are doing is, you're using 800, but you're paying for 2,000 just because there is a power factor in your house is really bad. Are we good? Can I give you guys a couple minutes and see if you can do question 2 or 3? Okay. Take an opportunity to try doing question 3 as well. Even in this question here. Am I given kilowatts?
No.
No?
You're giving, you got watts.
Just watts, no kilo? Okay, let's just do watts. What's given?
4,000.
Okay, how many KVA? So I'm just going to write on the word here.
5,500.
For me to find my power factor, what do? Watts over VA will lead to power factor. Perfect, you are on track here. 4,000 divided by 5,500. What do I get? 73% means 0.73. That will lead to 73%. What choice is it? A, B, C, D?
B.
B? There you go. You guys rock. That's why I say you are an intelligent class. Let's get it done. Move on to question 4. See how far you can go on your own. What's given and what we need to do?
Okay, we have...
On question 4, am I given kilowatts?
Yeah, we have watts, 300.
So kilowatts or watts?
Watts.
Watts. So I'm given 300 watts. How many VA is given to me?
200.
Am I looking for...
Watts
are given? V-A-R-S?
Yeah.
Watts are given. This is watts?
Yeah.
Okay. And what am I looking for? VA?
Yeah.
So on this triangle, as I showed you guys 5 minutes ago, what do? We put watts on the bottom side of the triangle. We put watts on the vertical side of the triangle. And the third becomes VA. So let's plug the values in. You're going to put 200 on the bottom side of the triangle, 300, and 200 on the vertical side of the triangle. How do you find the third side? This is easy step. Just do 200 squared. Your calculators will do it for you. Make your life easy. Press square root. Let's do it together. Pick up your calculator, press square root, then press a bracket button, then do 200 squared plus 300 squared. Bracket close and press square root. Press enter. That's all you do. What's your answer? You're going to do press square root, this square root, nice looking button. After that, you're going to press bracket button. Then press 200 with a square button. 200 with a square button and bracket close and then enter. What's your answer?
361.
Yeah, 361, and that's your V, and you got it. That's all he was asking. Two sides are given, find me the third side. Your calculators make your life easy these days, eh? For a change. Are we good? Do you want to move on to fifth one, or you want me to show you? Oh, yes.
I really don't care. I want to go home.
1200. So
four.
Question
four.
Five.
Yeah, 400.
400 kilowatts, okay. What else is given?
800 kVA.
KVA is 800.
Yeah.
What I gotta do is find kVAR's?
Yes.
kVAR's not given. So guys, this is even easier. Okay? When you're given the longest side of the triangle and one more other side, you're looking for the other smaller side. What do? Square, square, minus, rather than square, square, plus. Okay? How do? That? You take bigger number square minus smaller number square, take the square root, and this will give you your unknown. Life is simple. So, Tariq, you're going to go ahead, punch these numbers for me in your calculator, how I showed you, and tell me what will be your final answer.
693.
And that answer will be in R. And we are done. So, if calculators are bothering you guys, tell me, I can help you. Press square root, press a bracket button, 800 square minus 400 square, bracket close, enter. Okay, got it? I see some lost faces. Harman, your buddy seems lost. Are you helping him?
Yeah.
Make sure you do, okay? Okay, anybody else still in trouble or you got it? Can we move on to number six? Okay, now I'm going to ask Nathan to help me number six. Or help me with number six, dear. What's given?
135 amps.
Read the question for me, please.
Certain load is drawing 135 amps from 240 volt line and is operating at power factor of 0.5.
Perfect. What am I asked to find?
It's to be corrected to unity with capacitors, how many kVA does it draw before correction?
Question says, find me my kVA. This is your question. Do you see how I do things? When I read a question, I first of all don't read the whole thing. I read one sentence, write down what I understood. And so I can write down the piece of information given to me in broken parts. Okay? This question is even simpler than that, and I would call it a deceiving question. Some information is given to you that you don't need.
Yes, tricky.
Right? It's tricky. Why do you think I put it in your notes? Because that's how your exam is. There is stuff given to you that you really don't need to use. It's not a table from IKEA where every screw and nut has to go somewhere. You give some information. If you need to use it, use it. If it's given to you to distract you or deceive you, don't use it. Okay, in this case, do I need power factor to do my KVA? I am given V and A. What is V times A? VA. So what do? I find my VA. VA is 240 using watt law. Okay, times 135. Please tell me my answer. That's all I had to do. He said, this is my line current. This is my line voltage. What does line current mean? That's what is being perceived by the utility company because that's my line current. I'm being charged based on the current that my line is giving me to whatever load I'm attaching to. 135 and 240, what do I get?
32,400.
And so your answer will be in 32.4 kVA. ABCD, which one?
B.
B. And you are done. So do you think I needed this? Not in this question, maybe the next one. Do you get it? The reason I threw this question in your notes is because of that fact that you do get questions like that where you have extra information you don't need. Let's move on. Let's do question seven. I'm going to ask Sukhdev one to help me do question seven. Sukhdev, are you going to help me, dear?
Thank you.
are getting somewhere, so I'm going to confirm with you what your buddy says is true. Tell me question 7, what's given to you?
6 hours.
6 what?
6 hours. I joke. Question number 6.
Question number 6, I'm done. Tell me 7.
The 6 hours. We can take the question.
What is
the
question?
How many? Kilowatts. The question says, whatever we did in question 6, continue in 7 and find me my kilowatts. That's the question. Okay? For me to find my kilowatts, I gotta find my kilowatts first. Okay? I already know power factor and kVA. This is what I'm paying to my utility company, 32.4 kVA. What I'm practically using will be less, right? That's why my power factor is only 50%. So would I multiply or divide? Should I multiply kVA with power factor or divide, guys?
Multiply,
because if I divide, I'll be paying less and I'll be using more. That doesn't work practical life, okay? So kilowatts will become equal to kVA times power factor, which of course we know is the formula. What is my kVA given? 32.4 kVA, power factor is 0.5. What would I get? 16.2 kilowatts. Now I know two sides of the triangle. I'm gonna ask Simon to do some math for us. Simon, this side given here is 32.4,
yep,
which is my kVA. I've already figured out 16.2 kilowatts. For the third side, what I'd like you to do is square, square, minus. Take 32.4 square minus 16.2 square.
We have 475.
475 is what, dear?
It is
kVA. KVA is 475, okay.
Power factor is 0.44.
Power factor is 0.44.
We need to kVRs.
kVRs we need to find,
final,
and for that we should find kilowatts as well. Right?
Yes.
Until unless we have kilowatts, we can't find the third side of the triangle.
Yep.
So now, by you tell me, dear, for me to find my kilowatts, would I multiply these two guys or divide?
Multiply.
Multiply, good job. So multiply it for me, 475 and 0.44, what do I get?
209.
209,
yeah,
kilowatts?
Yes.
Yeah.
Is that what I got?
Yeah.
Okay. So what do I do next? After that, I'm going to find the value of kVAR, which is again square square minus. For me to get rid of my square root, I'll put a square root on the other side. I got kVA square and kilowatt square to find my answer. Now do this math for me, dear. 475 square minus 209 square, and then take the square root. Tell me my answer, please.
427.
426 even?
7.
27. And choices A, B, C, D, which one?
B.
B. And you guys rock. If you know these 8 questions, you got yourself question number 3 passed in your exam. 97 to go. We have covered 3. You guys don't know how far we covered everything that we need to know such that we can move on to wonderful world of Canadian electrical code. In your binder, next page after this, just gives you the heading. Why am I showing you this? What I really need to show you is the next page after that. Do you guys see all the sections with all the tables written down? This will come very handy for your life, especially for your exam. Okay? Each section, I've actually added it in your table. So every time you are working on one section, you exactly know what tables you're going to be using and what tables you don't have to worry about right now, because you're only working on one section. Okay? Let's get familiar with what our Bible looks like. So open up your code book. Without those kids. Are we good so far? Yes, no. I am dead. I don't know what you are doing. I want to go home. It's a Saturday. Pick ABCD out of ABCD pick one. You were not paying attention. I was giving you four options. When I said, why do you guys look so dead? Then I gave you four options. I want to go home. I just don't want to be here. It's a Saturday. Oh, yeah, I'm excited. I want to learn. Whatever it is, we're going to make the most out of our class, okay? Have fun while we are learning. On this list, you're going to highlight some stuff that's important. Pick up a pencil first, not a pen. Don't make a mess on your book. If you don't have a pencil, then you can use a pen if you don't have a choice.
Your
highlighted. These two pages that we are highlighting, very important from your code book usage. Okay? I'm going to ask this question from... from an engineering standpoint, how much is 1 inch in mm?
54.4.
Perfect. I knew an engineer would answer me a question. I'm going to ask Philip. Philip, how big is 1 inch pipe?
27.
So when you Google inches to mm online, under SI units, SI stands for Standard International, the conversion you will see is 25.4. It makes it easy for us to use a number that's a multiple. So multiple that we use here on this chart, 1 inch is 27 mm. Okay? So 1 inch pipe, 27 mm highlighted. In your exam, if the question says, I have a...
Is the external diameter internal?
The dia of this conduit, always internal. The space that's available to you is 27 mm.
But
okay?
In plumbing is 25 mm, why is that?
25. Again, there's the conversion that is used between any grid. Actually, what he's saying, what he was saying is 25.4, which is correct. 1 inch is 25.4, but from an electrical standpoint, doing a conversion from 25.4 and multiplying over 1 mm, 2 mm, and 3 mm, the rule of thumb is 27 mm. 1 inch is 27 mm, inch and a quarter. Inch and a quarter?
35.
35, 1.5 inch. In mm? Right in front of you. Again, don't use your brain. In my opinion, this exam, leave your practical experience at home, follow the book. It won't lie.
41.
How about 2 inches? 2 inches in mm?
53.
2.5 inches? 63. That's all you have to remember from your exam standpoint. Come to this table, find your answer, done. Are we good? Okay. Flip your page forward. The first section that you see is section 0. Keep going until you hit section 0. Section 0 talks about definitions. What is definition? And we didn't have google.ca, we still have Canadian Electrical Code. So it tells me all stuff that I need to know before I use my code book. Do you need to know anything from this? Section 0? Oh, I'm going to ask this question from Arman. And I hope you'll give me the right answer. What's the difference between overcurrent protection and overload protection?
Overcurrent protection is maybe for this protection, maybe we can use as the like breaker or fuses,
mm-hmm.
And for the overload is a
How would I give you an example, guys? I bought a toaster oven, it's 20 amps. I put this in the kitchen, what happens? How good is it the receptacle in my kitchen is? It says 20 amps, but where does it break? 80% of that, which is 16 amps. Average, that's the standard, right? Even if you're lucky then, right? From that standpoint, if I have a 20 amp toaster oven, what would happen? 5, 6, 7 seconds later, my breaker will trip. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. So, what's that? Why did it take me 5, 7, 10 seconds to really, circuit is not my brain, it doesn't take longer to respond, right? Why does it take 6 or 7 seconds for it to respond and the breaker to trip? Because it's thermal, good job. How is that breaker made? The manufacturing of the breaker is done, it's a bimetallic strip, two metals are put together, okay? And that's how a breaker is designed. This breaker is attached to a wire, and wire is going to the receptacle, which is my plug, and that's where the toaster oven is. Okay? So now, when I plug 20 amps, my wire is rated at 20 amps, which technically will be, again, capable of only 16, because 80% of that rating is allowed. So the wire, which has a capacity of a 16 amp, is carrying a 20 amp constant current. After 5, 4, 10 seconds later, the wire is going to get heated up. If the wire gets heated up, the wire is attached to this breaker. Okay? Because this is attached to this breaker, the metal that it's attached to is getting heated up. And this metal has a tendency, in the event melt, not melt, but it will expand and break. Okay, and that's how the breaker works. It's a bimetallic strip, right? The property of this metal, when it gets heated up, it expands and it breaks. Once it breaks, it will only make. In electrical terms, when we say break and make, not like break, like broken. Break means the connection is broken. It will make the connection again once it's cooled down. So that's why even when the breaker is stripped, we let it cool down for 20, 30, 50 seconds, and then we go back. It goes back to its off position, then it comes back to on. Yes or no? That's practical aspect of it. Why do we wait for 1 minute or 2 minutes for it to cool down? Because the breaker, the metal, comes back to its original state, and that's how it makes again the two metal plates. Okay? That's called overload. What is overcurrent? I just taught you parallel circuits. In a parallel circuit, think about house. Your house. Your house has a washer, dryer, lighting, all these loads. Load one, load two. They're all attached to the same panel. Okay? Four loads attached to, it's actually an AC source. I'm gonna write down an AC symbol, 120 volts. Okay? Let's say a crazy kid takes a plain piece of wire and shorts line and neutral on this plug. What would happen then? If it's not tamper resistant, the wire will go in, right? And if the wire goes in, it's connecting line to neutral. If line and neutral gets shorted, what's the resistance here?
Zero.
When the resistance of one load is 0 ohm, they are all connected parallel, R total is always less than the least value of the resistance. True or not true? Okay. In that case, my R total becomes 0 ohm because nothing can be less than 0. Okay. Total voltage is what value? 120. What will be my total current in that event? What I said. Theoretically, you will have, from a theory standpoint, not the practical standpoint, when you have no resistance, if I push this marker, it's going to go on and not stop. Yes or no? If the net resistance of any, let's say this chair I push, if chair doesn't have any resistance, I push it, it's going to keep going. Because there is some resistance, we have a response to an equipment, right? Anything I will move will stop at certain point because of the resistance. When net resistance becomes zero, anything divided by zero is infinity. So current will be tens and thousands of amps flowing through that circuit. If I didn't have a breaker, that will trip right away and will wait for the wire to heat it up, the whole house will be on fire. That's why we have something called overcurrent protection. The main breaker in our house, which is like a 200 amp breaker, is never designed with just the overload capacity. The way the main breaker is designed is based on, if you have taken 4 years of apprenticeship, even first year, they teach you Lenz's law. Does it ring the bell at all? It's gone with wind. Do you remember left-hand rule?
Left-hand.
Okay. In left-hand rule, let's talk about these fingers. So I'm going to try showing it to you what that really logically means. I've been told that people took apprenticeship, they still do not understand this rule very clearly. Pretty much this covers every basic electrical concept. So if current is going in this direction, this is field, okay? Whenever there is current, we hear these words, oh, there is electromagnetic field, or electric field, or magnetic field, or combination of electric and magnetic called electromagnetic field. What does that mean? A wire carrying tens and thousands of amps is gonna create a field, and field is always 90 degrees to the direction of current. What happens? Because there is so much field, it's gonna trip the breaker. That's how the main breakers are designed. They are designed on the principle of electromagnetic induction. They are not tripped because the bimetallic strip got heated up. They are tripped because the field is created so much more that it will trip the breaker. And who creates that field? Because we have tens and thousands of amps in the wire attached to that breaker. That's called protection. This is called, where am I? My throat is dead, sorry. Where was I? I was talking about current protection, but overload and overcurrent, right? So overload is actually, it takes longer time for it to react to overload, which could only be 5 or 10 or 20 amps more. But in case of overcurrent, lots and lots of ampacity is flowing because we are somehow creating a short circuit in our circuit. So that's the basic difference. So how do I know what the difference is? I will go to section 0 for definition to find that answer. If I don't know what a single dwelling unit is, if I ask this question from bug you. Nathan.
Ben?
Sensor, I was gonna bug you first.
Oh.
Nathan, you're gonna tell me this answer. This office, is that a single dwelling unit? No. What defines a dwelling unit? A motel room, is it a dwelling unit?
Yes.
Is that true? When we do a calculation as an electrician, let's say we don't have engineers going, we gotta do our own calculation. How do we calculate a motel room different than a house? No idea? Gonna read the definition of
dwelling unit
for me for D. Okay, read it out loud. Yes, please.
One or more rooms for the use of one or more persons as a whole for the cooking, eating, living, and food facilities.
I want each one of you to go to alphabet D. Look for the word dwelling unit. Highlight four words that Nathan just said. He said, any room that has what kind of, has a sleeping facility, a cooking facility, living facility, and eating facility, I think, right? If you have all these in a hotel room, that becomes a dwelling unit as well. So what I'm saying, what's the application of Section 0 from your exam standpoint? Nothing at this point, from your exam standpoint. For me, I personally feel it's great because it tells you everything you need to know before you even start using Kuhn-Yeni Electrical Codebook, okay? Now, I'd like you to flip your pages forward, go to Appendix B, first page of Appendix B. I want you to highlight the heading that says ground fault circuit interrupter. On page 391 of your code book.
391.
Do you see the heading that says ground fault circuit interrupter class A GFCI? Highlight that for me. Right underneath, I'd like you to highlight the first two lines. I'm going to read them out loud for you guys as well. Okay? A class A GFCI is an interrupter that will interrupt the circuit to the load when ground fault current is 6 milliamps or more, but not when the ground fault is less than 4 milliamps. Please just highlight it. The exam question may sound like, up to minimum, what ampacity should be there such that I need to install a ground fault circuit interrupter. A ground fault circuit interrupter will interrupt any load, anything, 6 milliamps or more. So your answer, A, B, C, D choices, 1 milliamp, 4 milliamp, 6 milliamp, 10 milliamp, your answer is 6 milliamp. Your answer is nowhere in the code book, but here, most of people, when they read the word ground fault circuit interrupter, they're looking for answers in section 14. So section 14 is protection and control. But your answers are not in section 14, it's in definition, which is right here in appendix B. Go back to the rule again. Let's go to first section that I'd like you to cover with me is section 2.